So my name is Philippe Coval, and I'm working from Samsung Open Source Group. I'm French, and I'm part of a team which is based in the UK, in London. And I'm working in France. And I have some kind of interest into Tizen, because I used to work before on Tizen with Intel, and now I keep working on it with Samsung. And I'm also in charge about IoTivity support on Tizen. So if you have any question related to those two domains, I will be, don't hesitate to ask me. I will try to help, because we want this to get good support. And outside, I am a curious mind, and I like DIY communities and interoperability between things and connecting different projects. That's the kind of things I like to do. So if you have a project which is somehow related to mine, don't hesitate to contact me. So promise, this talk is very, very technical. I will not talk about the future of prospect, about business, or everything like this. I will just focus on the things that matter, that just try to make run a basic application, and just have a crash course to get into these IoT things. So the project I'm talking about today is quite big, because it's there is a huge amount of line of code and a specification of 500 pages. So I want to avoid you to have to pay this price to get into the project, by just giving you some entry point and let you eventually make this demo or adapt to something different. I don't know. Just one question. How many people are coming from the software background in this room? And people who are most focused on products, and then they want to add the connectivity feature? Okay, there are a few. So that's really cool, because that's an opportunity to, I think that the both world needs each other. So if you are making software, nobody is putting into real product. It's like if you are virtually doing nothing. And in the same opposite way, if there are some products that don't add the needed software to use them, they are almost useless also. So I think we have a collaboration to set up. So I will explain about what is prototyping from my point of view. I will just start with a very, very basic example. Actually, there are some examples in IoTivity, but I remove all the code I could remove to make just the thing work. And I will explain this. And next, I will show how to make this real and interact with the hardware. And this little demonstration I show already. So if you're making a if you want to make an IoT product, probably you will not make it at first shot. First, you need to validate concept. And so if you are working in a R&D mode, it's totally different, because you can afford a lot of different hardware for different price. But if you want to make a product, an IoT product, we are talking about very, very low price and a very, very low consumption. And as a previous talk just before, very, very high security. So for development, that's not the way you used to work. So you probably prefer to work in a friendly environment using Linux, because you're comfortable with it. Having some shortcuts, you don't want to rely on complicated connectivity or add security. Or you can just focus on your concept and try to make it work first. But you should not put this aside, because this is very important. If you want to make a business, you have to think this also seriously. So people usually try to focus on a use case and then make it real. But some engineers like me just want to maybe just play with technology to get some inspiration, and then you can imagine what can be done with it. So sometimes it's a different approach. I have mostly the second one. But that's what I will explain today with this basic use case. So if you're looking for ideas, everything is possible. You can control whatever devices. You can do some monitoring using sensor. You can try to establish links with different domain or devices, like phones, for instance. Now, it's not unusual to have a phone to interact with industrial machine. So there is a lot of things to be done, and I just predict this is a beginning, because all those things will have some abilities to do things, and probably there will new behavior will be established in the future, and I'm not really surprised that prediction and artificial intelligence will try to make this more efficient. So I'm promising I wanted to make something simple, because I think this is where everything is starting. So you just, what I want you to do is just to grab the minimal source code, try to cut and paste it and tweak to add more feature, and then you can build your things. So what is the simplest use case? In the embedded world, usually we start by making a blinking LED. Every tutorial on Arduino is doing this. But a LED is not that stupid, because what you are doing here is an actuator. This means something that can turn on and off things. And many, many products we are using every day are just buttons. So if I want to turn off the music, I just flip a button. If I want to turn on the light, this is what I'm doing. So this is not as stupid as it means. So you can create your own switch, smart switch. So switch and button are somehow opposite. A button is a sensor that detecting the movement of the user, and the switch is the thing that turn on the device. So from this switch, we'll just first look at the basic function on off, and then we can do something very interesting, that we can also know the state of the switch if it's on and off. So this means if I have several devices, they can each other know that one device that turns this on and the other device known that it can turn it off because another one has turned it on. So you can have some intelligence into this scenario, and everything should be consistent. This means that if two people are turning it on at the same time and one doesn't react, then you have a problem. So to this use case, we need to identify the problem. The first one is sharing a resource and have a seamless connectivity between all the devices in your smart home or smart car or smart whatever. And one answer to this problem is IoTivity. So it's a framework to provide a connectivity between devices and many, many services. I will not explain them today. And IoTivity is the name of the project that is implementing the specification of Open Connectivity Foundation. So people can be confused when they see the boss name. What you need to understand is that Open Connectivity is a group of industry and many people. They agree to write a specification to make their device able to communicate together. And IoTVT is a reference implementation of this specification. So you're welcome to join this group as a company or individual. For individual, member fees are free. And you get access to the upcoming specification and what is going on in the project. So let's get back to IoTVT. One main feature is about discovery of the resource. This means I'm a network, I am a light bulb, I am a switch, I am a washing machine or whatever. You need to tell the others who you are and what you support. And then device can communicate together. So it's based on existing standard. IoTVT is a new name, but things underlying are existing before. We are using a core app for communication, which is a standard for made by Internet Tasking Force. And there is a security by design on this project. We are using DTLS for encryption. And for transport, it's agnostic. So you can use IP, Wi-Fi, Ethernet, or any other protocol like Bluetooth, Bluetooth Low Energy, and you can have Zigbee, Z-Wave, and other. There is a plug-in mechanism. So if you are relying on some kind of radio technology, you can add it, and you get all the upper stack working. So I'm not talking about data, device management, web services, cloud backend, plugins. There is so much things. I told you it's a very big project. I will just focus on the main thing about just establishing the connection. So a little vocabulary to get started. So resource is a word I will use the most in this presentation. resource is something that's describing something physical, like a button or a sensor, or eventually something virtual, which means a data in a program or a value of something, whatever. And you can also make a mix of real and virtual things, and you can eventually create some abstract sensor, like a mood sensor, for instance, which is a combination of the temperature and the humidity. So when you have those values correct, you feel in good mood. If it's not the case, this is a bad mood. So you can, when in your home, it's funny to know that when you're driving back to your home, try to make it the most comfortable possible with by monitoring those values. So each resource is described by a uniform resource identifier. So you can access them by their name. And the resource is composed of properties. So properties are value describing the resource. So for a temperature sensor, this is a temperature in degree or any other unit. And we can describe also the operation on those properties. So we call this by an interface that has operation. Operation to create, to update, to delete, to notify the change. And you can also have a model that is describing what is a resource and what is operation. So this is interesting. I will explain it a bit later. And you have also other concepts like a group or collection or links between resources if you want to create a more sophisticated system. So talking back to model, I want to share about an initiative inside OCF is to make a crowd-sourced shared communities, shared repository of existing resources. So if I we show you an example. So once we have the type of resource identified, this means that people are talking the same language and then can try to find each other and try to start talking. So that's quite interesting to define common objects to interact with. So from the description, you can also generate, it is used to generate a RESTful API. This is described in RaspberryPi, which is a YAML-based, it's a text actually. So, and I can show it after. So there is a simulator when you can, if you have described your resource, you can try to establish scenario and play it in a simulator. So let's, thank you. Let's, if you're looking for something, there's a switch in this case, there is a search engine. And if you look at it, there is a, several versions of it. What is a switch? So there is different kind of switch, but a special switch which is binary can be described by this official name. And what is it? It's just a value. This is a boolean, so it does has not many properties on off, and something readable for your human that can be used in a tool. So here is a resource type. Here is a property, the property name, and the property type. So that's very simple. So this is describing the switch. So I will just reuse again. But if I want to create mine with a three-state switch, I can just get inspiration and make mine. And if I want to share it back to the community, I can send a pull request on GitHub. I think they're using this. And eventually, people can use this kind of new switch. So now let's back to what we want. So first, when you're starting a project, you need to select specific hardware or specific operating system. It depends of your existing legacy project. So I'm talking about Linux today. If you cannot use Linux because you're working on more constrained devices, then you can just use bare metal development. For Linux, there is support already for Debian and Ubuntu. Yocto is providing layers called Meta OIC. Tizen, obviously, because this is a part of the platform. And I know that people are putting this in their router with OpenWRT, but it's a basic. I think it can be ported to any distribution of your choice. and also on non-Linux systems. You have support for Android, Windows, Mac, and so on. So that's the part for the software. And for the hardware, if you want to start developing, the most obvious thing is to use a single board computer. So this is quite affordable. There is a community support. So the most famous one I came to mind is Raspberry Pi. If you're using, if you want to use open source hardware board to make your own product, you can use different design. MinnowBoard is one of them. And the latest one is ARTIK, which is a Samsung development board. I have one of them here. And what you will find of this kind of board, you have access to input-output. You can have different buses and eventually antenna if you want to provide a wireless connectivity. And other things I will explain in detail. So to get started with IoTivity, there is we don't have a very good documentation at the moment. So it's, if you want to help on it, you're welcome to. But you just need to get the sources on. We are providing. We have a Git repository and a tarball, so you can just get them. And we are using the SCON build system. So SCONs are some advantage if you want to support many operating systems. It's a Python build tool, and it has a lot of flexibility. So once you have built the software, you have a shared library, and you can integrate and link it like any other library you used before. So just setting the linker flags, and you can use it. If you look at the source, if you want to start by one way, I would suggest to have a look at the sample application, which are in the example subfolder of the resource folder. And if you want to look at the API, there is a C++ folder where everything is. And if you're constrained and you want not to use C++ but directly the C core, you have a subset of the API of the SDK, which is a core only, and the C++ library is using this core, is in this folder. Oh, so what I'm going to explain here is only those 1, 2, 3, 4 steps to get the thing working. So first one is initialization, both side, client and server, registration of the resource on the server to say, hey, I'm okay to handle this. The discovery of the resource on the client side. And then let's start talking by getting and setting values. So this slide has an implementation in a project called IoTivity example. I will probably make more it visible on the IoTivity wiki later. But this is what is running on this prototype. So let's get started to the code. So on this side, I have the server, and on the other side is the client. So you can just start by writing your class with two executables. You will run one on the server side and one on the client side. And you just start by initializing the platform by just passing some parameters. So it's the same, exactly the same, from one side to another, except we are telling that this one is running in server mode and the other is working on client mode. So all of these are default value. Once you have set it up, you can just initialize the IoTivity framework and start using it. So this is only two lines of code. So for the registration of the resource, this is this function, register resource. We have a handler object, which we'll use later. We now tell the name of the resource by its name. So I use binary, relay, URI. You can call it whatever you want. You can have several resources and identify each of them. At the same time, identify each of them by a number. After, so you add a /1/2/up/down/whatever. Its name, I use the same name as the OCF one IoT name, but you can put whatever name you want. But if you're using something that's already existing, this means people who are aware of this name will be able to use it. So it's quite convenient. It's interface. This is default value. another object we set later. And let's tell some abilities of the resource. The most important one is that this resource can be discovered by others. So this means they don't need to know my name to use me. They can just ask who there and I will reply. And also observable, this means that if I'm changing, somebody or everyone who is interested into my new state will be aware about this change. So that's pretty cool. So we registered the resource on the server, and now client side we're doing the discovery. So we call a find resource function. And once it's done, it will call a callback function on the answer from the server. On find is the answer to find. So the find function. Okay, so first I tell that this is a C++ 11 specific function called bind. I will not explain it too much now, but if you find the resource, then you will get through this callback object and then call back this function. This is how it works. So this is a special name from CoAP calling that let's find everything that is on a network. This is how to say this in English. So every resource should be visible using this special endpoint name. I'm using IP protocol. If I'm using Bluetooth, I'm adding another one. I can use a combination of them also. And the quality of service, so which is set low, but it can be something different. And now I call the find resource. The IoTivity internal is seeing this request and is getting an answer, which is calling back our onFind function and passing this OC resource pointer, which is quite abstract. And then I can try to have a look at this resource and let's see if it's, what is its name, what is its type, and decide how can I handle this. So in the simplest case, okay, I was looking for a binary switch URI. In that case, if you found me, if I find you, I will create an object that be used to interact with. So let's start interacting with. So there is the post function to set a value of this resource. So there is a post function from the client, and the server will handle this request. So first we write this entity handler. This means on each request, how do we proceed? In the case of a post request, we'll do a special treatment for the post. If it's a get request, we do something maybe different, and so on. So I think, after I'm ending the request, I'm just giving back to the client his answer, and I'm just preparing a response. This can be anything. In my case, I'm just giving back the new state of the resource. So now, client side. So I was explaining what is done server side, but if you want to play it again, the client will make a request. And in my case, I'm changing the value of my property, which was a switch. I set to, let's say, on, for instance. On as soon as I discovered the device, I decide to turn it on, for instance. So I'm changing the value of the property. I'm making my request. Then the entity handler will decide to call the handle post function. This is not specific to IoTivity. This is my own design. And then I look for the input requests. I look at this representation of the resource. And I said, hey, let's see, you have a value, what is it? And I decide to update my system with this new value. So from the representation, I'm looking for a property, and then I'm looking for the property value. And then I decide to print on the on the terminal the new value, which is not very useful for now. So this is what, I'm not explaining it again, but this is what we did. So we have this initialization part, the entity handler, which is processing all the requests from the clients. And here are the different type of requests. So first we have the post one, then we have the get one to
get the value.
And we have this notify one. It's not an action, but it's a callback that's been called if the value has been changed. This means every client that has been configured to be observing the resource will get a callback call, and there will be known that the resource has been changed. So there is no special new things. If you're working on state machine, this is the same. So now let's go back to reality. So we are talking about resource, and mostly you want to use physical things. So probably most of people in this room know what is a GPIO, but here is a short resume. This is just how to control the voltage on one pin from the user space. So if I want to do this on Linux, there is different mechanism. The most generic one is using the sysfs mechanism. This means you can see the you can use the GPIO. First you need to export it to be use it, set its direction if it's an input or output. In our case of a smart switch, it is output. And if you just write it to this special file, it will turn on or off the current on this pin. So the most efficient way is to doing using direct access, using kernel. So you have to use special register when you can directly write into it. And there is also another library I used before, and it's quite convenient, called MRHA. It's something generic to do all the hardware abstraction. This means you don't have to care about details about how everything is mapped. You can just use the library, tell what kind of hardware you are using, and everything is working like magic. And also there is another project called UPM, which is a database of sensors. It is working together, so it's kind of convenient. So if we now know how to control the outside world using electricity, we just need to add this into our handle put function and decide to turn on the GPIO or off. That's all simple as that. So I wrote it in, you need to, let's say, write the file, this file you have been created before, and you write the new value of the property. So here is a development board I used in this demonstration. So this is it's a quite new product. It's called ARTIK. This is a Samsung is making new development board for IoT. You have Exynos SoC on it. It has 8 cores, so that's a lot of computing power, much more than what we need. And a lot of connectivity feature, antenna for wireless communication. You have several transceiver, and something quite interesting for makers and hackers is you have the same pinout.
That's Arduino board, so you can
make some different things. But let's go back to the example. We just will just change the value on the voltage on this pin. This is what we want to do. So the GPIO has a number, and when I want to use it, I just need to export it by this number using the previous mechanism, and then I can.
It will work.
So something I made before, if you want to do DIY, you have to create your own relay. So the problem is that you cannot put directly,
this board will not give you 200 volts. You get you need to control a relay, and the voltage is only 3 volts, so you have to adapt this. So I'm using a 5-volt relay, which is pretty common,
and with this transistor. So when there is some current here, the base is making this like a switch.
So I will not explain this too much, because if you want to prototyping, you better get some module. That's pretty.
So I think it's rather cheap, and you can get a lot of them. So I,
for the demonstration,
I use this this relay. This is an Arduino, so there is three pin, one for the signal, and then the
5 volt in and ground. That's all.
And then you can connect anything you want that behind this. So some things can be very cool for prototyping. Also, is using a daughter board like this one. So this is there is no CPU. This is just some electronics, and you just put on the board header, and you have all this functionality wired. So it will save you time. So this one is MinnowBoard. I have, maybe you don't know about this one, but yeah, they here. So this one is called the Rabbit Max for the Raspberry Pi. And it has the same relay as this one. So if you put this on top of Raspberry Pi, you have different kind of sensor. You can put extra one, you can put a display. So that's, I think this kind of board will save you a lot of time. For Arduino also, they're using their own shield format. And you need to take care about this, because they're using 5 volt voltage, while most development boards are using 3.3 volt. So don't screw your board with incompatible. So I know there are some adapter board when you can pull out an Arduino board on a Raspberry Pi or something like this. So now I'm talking about Linux on a development board. This is not IoT. IoT is about making very constrained devices. So it's cool for development. It's cool to validate concepts. So you probably will not use Linux on some products that's supposed to last 10 years on batteries or something like this. So you need to use probably a microcontroller, and with a very limited resource in time of memory. So we have a version of IoTivity, which is a core, I said, in C. You can use it. It's the same flow. And that's something really cool. I discovered that the same code base can run also on Linux or on Arduino. So it's maybe easier to debug a program on Linux than on Arduino board, for instance. So yeah. The sample I'm showing here is only 100K of footprint. So that gave you an idea. And I know there is, I will explain about it later. But do you remember the flow I showed? It was in C++. It's exactly the same in C. There is no difference. So now I can explain about once you have your IoTivity powered device, you can interact with other devices that also support IoTivity. So maybe there are several, but I know very well Tizen. So I can tell you that it's part of the platforms in the third version of Tizen. And for earlier versions, which is most of the product we have today, you can ship it as an application and it will also run. This is just an integration issue. In terms of functionality, the same. So I have this running on my watch, my phone. Now I just need a TV, maybe. And if you want to also support, interact with other Linux systems, we made some effort to support Yocto. So this means any project using Yocto can get this IoTivity feature without a pain. It's called Meta OIC Layer. So we have Poki support, obviously, and so automotive distribution, GENIVI, AGL, and also Intel system also, and also other systems like Android and Windows and so on. So maybe you already see this because I was making the King demonstration, but I can show it again and explain it. So this is a fan connected to hub with a relay and with a client on my phone. I made this very basic application. From first click, it is discovering the resource. and then I can decide to change the value. So there is a three button. The middle button is just toggling the value to the opposite value. So the same application, and when I'm telling it's the same, it's actually the same. It's the same code base, just with different config parameters. It's running on this watch. So something interesting that if I have several devices sharing the same resource,
they will be updated each other
on each change. Yeah, so that's what I'm showing here. So if you look at the value here is 0 and 1,
it's updated in real time in different places.
The demo, what is the wireless?
I use Wi-Fi because I don't have the driver for the Wi-Fi of my development board. But as I said, it can support different device. For this kind of wearable, Bluetooth low energy will be the best option for this kind of experiment. But IP was easier for me because I can set work on my desktop machine and then I just bought it. But it works. I mean, if you have a device that supports IP, somehow the job is done. So something I can also I can also put this into a
home router. This is something I can do, integrate it into. So I have my home gateway.
So on the demonstration, all the on the watch and the phone and on the development board are running Tizen, different version, but this is the same operating system.
But I didn't want to make this talk specific on Tizen because it's OS agnostic, so it doesn't make sense to focus on only one. So now from this, what do you want to do? Probably it makes sense to look at security because this is a very important topic. So to use it, you just need to build the library again with a security flag on. Something like this is not difficult. But first time you will run your program, it will not work because you need to first install the certificate to establish a trust between the framework and your program. There are some tools in Tizen specific for establishing provisioning, and you can also onboard devices. You can. This is something you would expect from a secure IoT system. And if you're looking at if your system, your hardware is very constrained, then there is also another version of IoTivity which is even more constrained than the C version of the SDK. It has been presented, I think, 2 days ago. And I think it's quite something that can be interesting to test on different operating systems. And in terms of connectivity, this is to answer your question, there is a lot of transport system. And once you have done this into your very limited use case, maybe you can also consider to scale it at a larger level. This means you can eventually deploy a network of the same unit and see how they can they interact together, establish rules between them, and eventually have a global backend. This means using cloud services when you can add some value also on this, and eventually try to make it getting along other devices in a context. So this means if you are making a home appliance, maybe it's interesting to have a look about what is supposed to be in a smart home and see if you can interact with them. And something that can be really amazing also is to see how can different contexts can interact together. This means if I have something in my car and my home, maybe they can find a way to communicate. This means that they can, I don't know, I'm not a designer of use case, but let's say it's winter, it's a very cold outside, your car is a very low temperature, and when you are preparing your coffee, maybe the system can say, okay, it's very cold, so it's better. You can turn on the heater while you're drinking your coffee. So that's the kind of thing possible. And you can sing anything. That's all open, I think.
So yeah, about the car, this is a previous demo I made with a different system. So I'm using the same Tizen devices along
automotive operating system.
For instance, there is a map application, and we have also the position model,
so we can also create applications that deal with position of something. So that's very basic, but you can, it's opening a lot of possibilities. So what I want you to remember, that prototyping something from scratch is possible. You don't need to rely on a lot of technology like a system like cloud or keys, or just grab the code, build it, and you have already a device-to-device connectivity. So maybe this is not the Internet of Things, but this is IP of Things, because they're talking IP together. There is no connection to the Internet. So you can already set up some new intelligence between your devices. And resource, creation of the resource, changing the state of the resource is something we can easily do in C or C++. You can deploy this quite easily on existing single board computer on your favorite Linux distribution. And once you have done this, there are some devices that are ready to talk with you. So Tizen is one of them, but in the OC Open Connectivity Foundation, there is more than, I should check for the update, but 200 or maybe more companies who want to make a product implementing this protocol. And then it's just up to you to create what you want. So here is a few links. You will check online later the slide if you want to have a look. I want to just communicate about if you want to be in touch with me or other people. In Tizen, we are making some monthly meeting from one time to another. If that's, you have something in mind and you want to share, that's a place to do. It's very informal. There is no special agenda. We are doing this on IRC. We're just trying to find 1 hour and somebody show up and explain something. That's how we proceed. And I will try to explain this and share my code and explain how to use this also. So thank you for being here. And if you have some question, I can answer them. But I think I'm quite, I have some time for question, but I can also show you more stuff. So I'm open to any question now, if you want. Yeah, sure.
Probably you already talked a bit about it, but I didn't get it exactly. So which protocol is it? It's just plain IP, or are you using TCP/UDP?
Okay, good question. I said I went go to the code, but I will not explain the network. But yeah, IoTivity is a new name, and there is actually a lot of things embedded into this. So for communication, we are using CoAP protocol, which is based on UDP. We don't use TCP because on constrained devices it doesn't work. It cannot fit into the constraint. And if you ask also about TCP, there is some version about using TCP also. In the latest version, 1.2, you can use TCP. And also XMPP in the other cases. And so it's quite flexible. There is a minimum use case that should address at least the core of the specification. But then you can create anything, and it's providing service to do this. Yeah. Oh, one thing I can explain also. For the discovery of the device, we are using multicast. So this means that on the network, everyone can listen to who is going on. My presentation is focused online because I wanted to make it the simplest possible, but no, it's everything is to say this in another world. What the most you can, the least you can do. So, but I prefer to have an approach in a
to the simplest, to the most difficult, and in the observation. Especially, it can be confusing because if somebody is new to this project, he just downloads this huge amount of code and he can get lost quite easily. So this use case, I think, is very simple. Both are supported. Maybe I should repeat the question for the video. The question is about IPv6 and IPv4, and I think both are supported. Leon, you have a question.
Yes. Is it possible to use this with existing systems based on
IoT? Yeah. There is a language. I never made it work already, but if you look at the tree, just grab, you will find it. Also, lightweight M2M. People have made some experience. Michael.
So if it's transport agnostic, then you can use maybe Zigbee or Bluetooth, like your slides show.
Yeah.
But if you say it integrates MDNS, CoAP, DTLS, all of these IP things that require IP. A Bluetooth PicoNet has no IP addresses.
No, but we can adapt. There are MAC addresses. I don't know about the Bluetooth implementation, but encryption, yeah, probably is the same, but not an IP packet. It should be a Bluetooth packet. Stefan? Yeah.
When I
was initializing my client, I said I am discoverable. So if I'm not discoverable, so the client should explicitly call me by my identifier. So it's not restrictive, but. So there is a lot of facilities if you are using those services. Okay, if you don't have some more questions, I can show you extra stuff.
This is the same version on of the demonstration, but you're running on Arduino. This is a here is a server, and this is a RabbitMax from Leon running as a client. And I have a small button on it, so I'm just turning it on with a button. And you have this amazing plasma board, but I didn't carry it with me. So now, something that can be, I think it can be useful when you want to establish some use case. You have a simulator, so the first thing you have to do is to load
a model, which is described in RAML language on the repository.
And once you load it, the device, where is it? Yeah, it has you're seeing the properties at value, which is set to true, and the device has an identifier, and you can start interacting with it.
What I wanted to show is
here you have the URI
of the device. I use the same name in my C code, but it can be anything else.
So here is the client side. When you starting it, you will find the
resource under its name, and
if you click on it, you can
see the
you have a little UI where you can change the value of the resource.
So
here I'm showing a problem because I said that I want to make a put request on this device, and it's not supported by the model. You can only post. There is a little ambiguity with it. So if I do it again using the post, it will work.
Okay, nice. Now
this is when the value has been changed.
Oh, sorry.
This is yes, we are on the server side, and we get this is we're giving back the answer to the put request from the client.
I think I'm over for now, but if you have some extra question, find me after. Or, yeah, sure. Yes. Yes, there is a project called IoTivity node, and it was shown two days ago, I think, by you can have what I've shown in C++, you can have something similar in JavaScript and maybe less code than C++. Yeah, that's a good remark, because we predict that most people who design IoTivity devices or service will probably not be embedded developers, because if it doesn't scale, there is not enough people familiar with this embedded technology to address all the needs of the market. So anyway, I will share my code. I will make it more visible. And if you want to have a look and eventually port to a new system or new device, I will be really interested to know if you had some issue about integrating this or not. Yeah. And thank you again.